everyone, and thank you for coming out to the Dworkin and Bernstein Management Lecture Series this semester. We really appreciate your coming out in the lovely night, but it's lovely to have you out here this evening. I think you're going to really enjoy our presentation tonight with Alyson Scott from the Fredon Corporation. Just want to give a little bit of information about the Fredon Corporation, and then I'll introduce Alyson, and then I'll let her talk. The Fredon Corporation is based in Mentor, Ohio. It's been in business for 44 years and offers complete manufacturing solutions for precision machining needs. They do a lot of custom machining. They do a lot of prototyping for businesses in the aerospace and nuclear and other industries. It's a $15.5 million company, and just in the past few years, Fredon has been awarded the Crane's Leading Edge Award, the Lake Geauga Fast Track 50 several times, and the Weatherhead 100 Award. Alyson Scott is currently the Chief Financial Officer of the Fredon Corporation, and where she has worked for 16 years. She holds a bachelor's degree in English from Denison University. She's a member of the board of directors for the Mentor Area Chamber of Commerce and is on the board of trustees for the Lake County Development Council. I believe she's also on the Lakeland Foundation Board. She also serves on the board of the Alliance for Working Together, AWT Foundation, and chairs the annual AWT RoboBot Competition, which is actually combat robotics, where the robots are fighting each other, which is very cool. She's a proud graduate of Leadership Lake County in 1988, a past member of the Facility Corporation Board that helped establish the women's fraternity Kappa, Alpha, Theta at John Carroll University. She's in her fifth year teaching fourth grade at the PSR program at St. Gabriel's Parish in Concord, Ohio. Alyson and her husband, Chris, have two children, Chase and Max, and they reside in Mentor. So if we can please have a round of applause for Alyson Scott.
Thank you, Chris. I appreciate it. So they're a little bit older than my fourth graders. I think I'll be okay, though. So it's a little bit different than my normal presentation. I've been doing a lot of presentations on manufacturing and the robobots, as Chris mentioned, which is the combat robots competition that we will have here at Lakeland in April. So it's a little bit of a shift. I was kind of out of my element a little bit, asking, kind of self-reflecting and figuring out what leadership means to me and management and all of these kinds of things. So it was very, very new. So if I default into my presentation about robobots, you know why. So I hit a major milestone this year that my dad likes to remind me of continuously. Dad, what happened? Yeah, I turned 40. I'm having a hard time with it, really. I know it's going to be okay, it's a new chapter in your life and all this kind of stuff, but I really was thinking that when you're in your 40s, that you've kind of gotten to a point in your life where you're established and you know, are responsible and everything. I just had a different perspective of what 40 looked like, kind of like that. I was pretty sure that when I was 40, I was going to look like that. Not that Betty White isn't fabulous and fun, but I really see myself more like this. Young and vibrant, right, Dad? He tells me I'm old. I swear I'm not. So I guess, realistically speaking, at the age of 40, you have traveled some roads and do have a few miles under your belt. So I guess I can't give him too hard of a time calling me old. I'm just mature and seasoned, that's all. So the road that led me here, I was born in Cleveland, adopted by two wonderful parents. I went to Denison University where I met my husband. We were college sweethearts. When I was in college, you know, I laugh because my English degree, you know, we were talking before about how degrees in college don't necessarily relate to what you end up doing. But I guess it does in a sense, you know, in a very, you segue it in how you can. And the reason I say this is my plan was always to go to school and become a teacher. I was going to be an English teacher, 7 through 12. And then, you know, in college, I was doing a lot of thinking and thought about what makes a teacher a great teacher. And it's that consistent passion, continually passionate about the students, passionate about the work that they're teaching. And I just felt like knowing me and knowing my love for leadership and kind of going in that direction, that I wouldn't probably be a teacher for very long. I would go into the administrative side of things. And I thought, well, I'm not really sure that that's then what I want to do, what I love to do. So anyway, second semester of junior year, I made the decision to change my major. I was a little nervous of how that conversation was going to go with my parents. But more importantly, I was afraid of what that meant for me and my future. You know, it's easy when you have a degree such as a teaching degree or a nursing degree or some or an engineering degree. You kind of know what you're supposed to do. So it kind of opened up things, which is a good and a bad thing. So I find ways to bring in that teaching element into my job now by doing things such as robobots and working with students that way. So it's not that I've given it up altogether. And of course, teaching PSR helps me kind of flex that teacher muscle. So I graduated college, worked for the Cleveland Botanical Garden for a little bit of time. Went to work at Fredon before my husband and I got married. It was a year after college. We decided that we were going to live in Seattle. So the two of us picked up everything, and us and our U-Haul and some dollars in the bank, we moved to Seattle. Not having jobs lined up for when we got there. Chris was had a line on some work, but I didn't. It was just kind of that time in your life when you can just pick up everything and go. And it was a fabulous opportunity. I do not regret it at all. I wouldn't change a thing. Being there and away from the family and in a place that just didn't feel like home, we made the decision after a year to move back to Cleveland. So we got back in the U-Haul and came back. And I asked I asked my dad if I could come and work in the business. I didn't want him to make up a job for me, which he ended up pretty much doing anyway. But it was important to me to come home and to resume, you know, that world and being a part of that family business. So I've been there now for, I guess, 17 years on Wednesday, actually. It's a long time. I can't believe it's gone that far. Chris had mentioned a little bit of what Fredon is, and we are one of 700 manufacturers in Lake County. That's a lot of manufacturing companies just right here. Part of our work, aside from making parts, is to promote rewarding careers in manufacturing, and that's some of the work we do with the Alliance for Working Together. So it's not just about making parts every day. That's of course our day job, but it's one of our loves and passions to introduce students to what manufacturing is all about. It is a family-owned business. As I said, my dad started it in 1969, and he has some big shoes to fill, definitely. And if anybody knows my dad, then you know that he's got a lot of chutzpah, I guess is a better way to put it. He's very passionate and very knowledgeable, and just there's so many things that make him a great leader that I hope I can take half of that and aspire to be as good of a leader as he is. So he's a wonderful example on what a leader should look like in business. So I guess, my mom will love this picture, I think. According to psychology, that they feel that the personality of someone is formed by the age of 6, which I'm a little bit younger than 6 in that picture. I suppose that's true. If you think back on yourself and you think of what kind of child you were and what you were interested in, deep down, it's probably all the same stuff that you're doing now. It's just different activities, that's all. So I'm still the person that raises her hand and volunteers for everything. And I'm always wanting to be busy and always wanting to join things and do my best and work hard. My mom says I was a little bit of a know-it-all, which I guess some things don't change. I still know it all. and, you know, it's We have to take that into consideration when we're looking at what we want to do and where we want to be. You know, take all of those things that make up who you are, instead of trying to be someone else. You know, reflect and figure it out and figure out what your strengths are. Well, I was going to say that this is my son. And if the fact that your personality is formed by the age of six, I'm a little concerned. I'm not quite sure what he will be when he grows up. Farming, I don't know. This is his costume for Halloween. He says that he wanted to be a cow because it's so weird, it's scary. So when preparing for this speech, I was looking through some stuff and found this note that I'm sure some of you have done in high school or grade school, where you write a note to yourself and then you mail it and you don't open it for whatever years. So I laughed at it. You know, the goals that I set at the beginning of high school, to get good grades, to study, make a lot of friends, discover who I am. I'd say I did a lot of things like that. One thing I would change, well, I guess that's two things. Study more, work harder. I think that's always a good thing to work on. And appreciate my parents more, which I hope to do more and more as I grow and understand all of the things that they had to go through. As I am a parent now, and I totally relate to what they had to go through with me. In the next 10 years, of course, get married, have a stable life, have a good job. I'm not sure. I knew the newspaper bit because I was very interested in becoming a reporter at one time, and had a nice experience with an internship at the News Herald. That was a lot of fun. Hospital, I'm not quite sure where that came from. I really don't remember that one. I did do some volunteer work at the hospital, so maybe that's where I came from. That came from. Still have some of my close friends, have a great family life. And then, of course, it's the little affirmation on the bottom I just cracked up at. You're still the most excellent person, even if you don't achieve every single goal in life. I think that's good advice to myself, and I have to remember that always. It's interesting when you have the opportunity to look at something like that, having those years behind you, and seeing all the same stuff. It's pretty cool. So, leadership, that is what we are here for, to talk about. Leadership, the power or ability to lead other people. Leaders have a vision of where the group is headed. Now, management is the ability to bring order and consistency using that authority that comes with your position. So there's that little duck, and he is leading his family, and he is also managing the line, and everything is nice and neat. There are some traits that I feel are critical to becoming a great leader, just reflecting in my own personal experience. And those are some of the things that I'm going to share with you. What does it mean to lead, to direct, to guide on a course? You know, at the end of the day, it's kind of like those members and crew, you know, where there's the person at the front who's saying, stroke, stroke, stroke. You know, you're not telling them how to necessarily work their stroke, but you're pointing them in the right direction, and you're telling them how to be on time and work for the benefit of the boat, of everyone. So that is a lot of what it means to manage people, really. It is an honor if someone considers you a great leader. I mean, that says a lot, I think, for your own people to really look at you and say, they're doing a great job. I feel comfortable. I feel that they are leading me in the right direction, and me and my group or whatever. These values, their characteristics, some of you might share the same. Some of them might be different than your personal beliefs, but these are mine. So who's this? This is audience participation. Who is that? Abraham Lincoln. Why do I have a picture of Abraham Lincoln? He was a president, yes, but what? What was that? He was honest, somebody said? Absolutely. He was a man of great integrity. He was always honest. And that's something that I feel is important, honesty and integrity. You have to, it's sometimes scary to be honest, because let's face it, you're not always telling the person something they want to hear. You don't know the outcome necessarily of how they're going to react. But nevertheless, you have to be honest, because that's what you have to fall back on. That becomes your reputation. You know, if someone can't trust, if they find out that you've lied or misguided them in some way, even in business, in life, they're not going to trust you. You know, it's going to, all that credibility is going to go away. And if you're honest, even if they don't like the answer that you have or the words that you're going to give them, they know that they can trust you. And hopefully that will bring them coming back for years, you know, if it's a customer. It was a learning experience for me, having a customer, and for whatever, there were a lot of circumstances, but we ended up having to call the customer and telling them that we had lost some key personnel that were the ones that had been working primarily with that customer. And it was a little bit, the skills that person possessed were a little bit out of the wheelhouse of what we had. So we had to call her and tell her what had happened, of course, because we had to be honest with her. We didn't know if that would mean that they're gonna take their business because they don't have faith in us and our abilities. I mean, I had to be honest and tell her, look, we may not have those same skills, but we will give you our 100% of our effort. We will always be honest with you. If there's something that we run into that we cannot do, we will tell you. And you know, she was brutally honest back and made me shake in my boots a little bit. But you know, at the end of the day, they're still one of our customers because of that honesty. They knew that that's the type of business that we ran. You know, if we were able to come to them with something that admitted a weakness at the time, and yet still rise to the occasion, we were able to do what we needed to do to continue on that work. There were a couple things that we didn't do, and that's okay. But she appreciated our honesty, and I think that we won her over for that. Who's that? Aretha Franklin. Why do I have a picture of Aretha Franklin up there? I'm sure you all know. Respect, absolutely. I mean, who doesn't know that song? Definitely need to remember that. You need respect, you need to give it, and you need to earn it. I think that it is important to show the people that you work with that you respect them, no matter what position that they're in, no matter where they came from or whatever. Respect the skills that they bring, respect the efforts that they're making for the benefit of your company. If you don't treat them fairly and kindly, they will see that you have no respect for them. And if you have no respect for them, why should they come and, you know, come to work every day and give all their efforts to help you succeed? They're certainly not going to respect you back. And there are some people that you have their respect until you lose it. You know, they respect the position that you have. You know, you come in as a manager, they're going to respect you until you do them wrong. Then there are other people that won't give you respect until you earn it. And I think that being in a family business, that's kind of the side I have experienced a lot, I think, with especially some of the older coworkers, I think. And I don't fault them for that. That is absolutely a fair way to be. I needed to have an opportunity to prove myself that I was able to do what I was there to do. So until I had that first customer contract done and they could see how I worked through it and see that I was able to come to the table and have that conversation and have it work out and have a good benefit, I covered for one of our coworkers while she was on maternity leave, and that was something that, you know, I was scared to death of because she did payroll and all this stuff. I was freaking out thinking, I'm never going to be able to do that. But she trained me. I rose to the occasion, and I think I got a lot of respect for that too. Because until I showed people what I could do, they had nothing to go off of. You know, I was the boss's kid that came in, and, you know, for whatever reason, they may assume that I don't know anything or I'm there to take advantage of it. I tell you, a lot of family business people, it's sometimes harder to get over that hump that people assume that you are there because you knew somebody or you're related to somebody. So it's kind of, people think, well, if you're in a family business, that's easy. You know, you can't get fired, they pay you a lot of money, you know, it's great. Well, it's challenging too, because your behavior is magnified. Everybody's watching to see what you do. Everybody's watching to see if you really can do what you're there to do. They are watching, making sure that you're there every day and on time and all of those same things that you expect of them. And so you really, it's kind of a little challenge, but absolutely a fair perspective for someone to expect you to prove yourself and gain the respect. So what do you think? This little girl crossing her fingers, hoping for the best. It's optimism. And people think, I think some people I work with think I'm kind of naive or something, you know, like blissfully unaware, and that's how I can just be happy and look at the bright side. And, you know, it's optimism. You know, you can wake up in the morning. Everybody has a choice when you wake up. You can have a good day, you can have a bad day. It's your choice. Your circumstances can be the same. The circumstances are not what give you a good day or bad day, because they can be crappy. I mean, you can, but if you have a positive attitude and you realize, you know, hey, this is not going to let me down or get me down, you can turn that day into a good day. You know, you have that choice. I choose to hope for the best. I choose to see the best in every situation. Sometimes, yeah, I suppose it is a little naive, but you need to be a cheerleader sometimes as that leader. You know, you don't want to be the one, the doom and gloom that, you know, why are they going to get behind you and be excited about something or have faith in themselves or whatever if you don't either. I mean, if your negativity will absolutely sink into them and you know, you're going to have a bad situation for sure. It's tougher to look at the bright side sometimes. I will definitely give you that. Your attitude won't change the situation. Your attitude will not make a bad situation disappear, but it will change the outcome, how you let it feel, how you feel about the outcome, and how the outcome affects the people around you. So, yes, hope and pray for the best. Prepare for the worst. Be real. I mean, you don't want to be completely naive, but. So this little guy, you know, a cat is not going to act like a lion unless it really thinks it is a lion. It's got its self-confidence. That's a big thing. The confidence to believe in yourself and your skills. You need to be confident in who you are, that you are in a position to lead because you earned it, because people respect you, because you have that reputation of good character. You know your abilities, you know your weaknesses. Instead of focusing on the weaknesses and not really having that sense of confidence, figure out what you are good at and surround yourself with a good team of people who can cover everything else. One of my downfalls, I think, being in manufacturing is that I didn't come from the floor. I don't know manufacturing the way our machinists do, our engineers do, but that's okay. My gift and what I bring to the table is not that, but I serve another purpose. I mean, the things that I do are valuable. Not all of the team can be giving the same things. You don't want everybody to have the same skill set, because then you're gonna end up having people who, just like robot teams, we tell teachers, create a team of different types of people. Because if you have the same type of person, all that's gonna happen is you're gonna have one person that does all the work and five other people that sit back and let them do all the work. Whereas if you have somebody, a team made up of people that have their own strengths and have their own thing that they are in charge of, you know, the thing that they do best, you know, whether it's marketing, the group or the presentation or CAD or whatever it is in that situation, you know, work upon their strength instead of trying to duplicate everything. You don't have to be everything. You know, it's okay if I don't know manufacturing, because I have complete faith in the team that I have, that they know what they're doing, and I will definitely defer to them. It's tough to, coming into a manufacturing world, which is very male-dominated, I mean, not so much anymore, we were talking about this before, I really think it's starting to change, especially in engineering. I think women are becoming engineers a little bit more often. They're confident in their math skills and science and things like that that they may not have been encouraged to pursue. But being in an environment that is largely male and coming in as a female can be a little intimidating, if you let it intimidate you. Being young when you come into the business is another thing. You know, you can be a little nervous about that, or you can know that you have great abilities, that you are a confident person, you can own the world and not let it bother you. You know, when I went through Leadership Lake County in 98, not 88, but I still was one of the youngest people on the team, and I thought, oh my gosh, what are they going to learn from me? What do I have to offer? I mean, I'm 23 years old or 24 years old. What? I really think I'm in the wrong place. But I was confident. I was there for a reason. I chose to be there just like all of them, and you know, it didn't bother me. It ended up fine because I didn't let it bother me. I trusted in myself, my own abilities, and I had that self-confidence to not, you know, be afraid of the situation. I think that if you take the easy route, you're always going to get stuck in a rut. You'll get to a certain place. If you don't take that step and try something that maybe puts you out of your comfort zone, you're certainly never going to grow. So have your self-confidence, trust in yourself and your abilities. I like this one. Change, adaptability. Change is scary. A lot of people think that. A lot of people fear change. So being the pioneer behind a paradigm shift is not an easy place to be. To try and get a group of people who have been doing things the certain way and they have been working all along to say, hey, let's try something new. Let's bring in this great new way of doing things. You know, you're going to get a lot of kind of negativity, if you will. You're going to get a lot of doubt. People aren't going to believe that you know what you're talking about because it's different. But change is good. Change can move you and your company or your team to a next level. You know, just because you've been doing it and it's been working doesn't necessarily mean it has to be done like that. There is some benefit. You know, everybody, we're doing this new thing at work, this lean training that we're doing. It's a big thing, lean manufacturing. It's a very good idea and very good process. I think that philosophically, it makes a lot of sense. You coin a word, lean manufacturing, and all the customers are saying you have to have lean manufacturing team, and you have to do this, and you have to do continuous improvement events. You know, you kind of put your feet and stick your heels to the ground and say, is this really going to benefit us? Like, do we really need this? Why do we have to change? Why do we have to do this? Well, you know, times are changing. This is what our customers expect. And so guess what, guys? We're going to do it. And we're going to do it great. And we're going to take advantage of the benefits that it gives and brings us. May not be something that we plan on. We might not be all for it. We might have some doubters. But we're going to go ahead and we're going to do it. And we know that in the end, it will make us a better company. And whether it's better because you've gone through it and you see that it doesn't apply to you or that you are doing good things the way that you're doing them, I mean, that's important too, you know, to reaffirm what you're doing. Or it introduces something that really saves you a lot of time, a lot of money, makes things more efficient. So you really have to be open to change, to adaptability, to just kind of roll with it. Otherwise, you'll get stuck. So this one, this is a big one. Trust. My son actually, I laugh because he sent us this little video when he stayed out in Seattle with my in-laws an extra week this summer and had the opportunity to take, my sister-in-law took him to a trapeze lesson. I said, oh my God, he's never going to want to come home. You know, we make him clean his room and pick up dog poop and stuff, and she's taking him trapeze lessons. So, you know, they give some instruction and they put the kids up there. And I see him at the top of the ledge, and the bar comes, and he gets on there, and he's swinging, and he puts his little legs up, and yeah, I mean, he's 14 years old, he's got long legs, but he puts his legs out there, and you hear the woman telling him, all right, now let go. And he, honest to God, just bends back, and he cannot see the person, and he puts his arms out, and they grab him. He doesn't fall, he does it perfectly, it's perfect execution, I couldn't believe it. I'd have a hard time doing that, honestly. Even if you know, I mean, they're not going to let you fall. I mean, they're there. It's their job. I mean, their liability is not going to put somebody up there that can't do what they need you to do, somebody that can't catch you. But taking that final step, I mean, that's a little scary. To not know what the future is, to not be guaranteed of the outcome. I mean, you hope, you know what's going to happen, but there's no guarantees. So you have to trust the people. You have to trust the person that's holding their arms out for you before you let go. I trust that I have a bunch of people that I am surrounded by, that are passionate and knowledgeable and will have my back. I don't worry and hesitate before I go into a meeting with a customer where they're, you know, it was very strange. This other customer we had a long time ago, he was something else, let me tell you. He was of the philosophy of change by manipulation and bullying. You know, he kind of wanted to get me to change my answer by just intimidating me. And my answer to him was, I trust my team. If he said it this way, then that is what it is. I completely trust him. I'm not going to change my mind. I'm going to put my faith in him and hope to God he is right. But I trust him, and it's never let me down. So equally important, it's very important to trust yourself. You know, if you don't trust yourself, you're going to find yourself in a place where you're afraid to make a decision. You're going to be paralyzed with indecision. That's a phrase we always love in my house. I'm paralyzed with indecision sometimes. It's because you're not so sure that you want to make that final decision, that final choice. Like, what if I didn't think about this? Or what if it fails? Or what if I didn't know enough or ask enough questions? What then? Well, you gotta trust in yourself. You gotta trust that you've done your homework. You gotta trust that you have gotten to where you are by learning and educating yourself, and trust that you will make the right decision, or you will be stuck and paralyzed with indecision. I mean, that's a big one. You know, to trust other people is important, yes, but to trust yourself is huge, especially when you come to those life-changing times. You know, when you're a junior in college and you're changing your major, second semester of junior year, you're not so sure how it's going to turn out, but you got to trust that, you know, it's your gut and your experience and your research or whatever it is that you've done, and trust that you've made the right decision for you. Otherwise, I think what you end up with, which is almost worse than not being able to make a choice, is that regret. I think that you don't want to second guess yourself. I don't know. Trust, my advice is go for it. Trust yourself. Trust that you know what you're doing. And go ahead, pull the trigger. This little guy is my favorite. By golly, this guy, he has really given me some ideas on what we should do before our next customer meeting or negotiation or something. You know, yeah, you're going into the trap, but you know, at least you got a helmet on. The reason I put this one up is moxie. I love that word. That's a cool word. Moxie. And moxie, it's the ability to go forward even in a bad situation or an unsure situation, to have that courage, to have that determination. Every entrepreneur has moxie. My dad got a lot of moxie. He forged ahead, trusted himself, knew what he wanted to do, and he was determined to make it a success. I think that the more, as you go on in your career and as you finish up your schooling, if you want something, regardless of what situation you are in, go into it. Have that moxie, that determination, and know the outcome will be good. Know that you are determined to make your life, your career, whatever it is, successful. You know, a great leader will always have this, will always have this moxie. You know, it has to be the one that will be able to forge ahead with determination and not fear what's going on. You know, not backing down. I love it, moxie. So, we have my list back here to go over. Integrity, Integrity and honesty is hugely important. I think that reputation is everything, especially in a world that is based on relationships, which our job is, our manufacturing company. I mean, we're a custom manufacturer, so we don't have a product that goes on the shelf. So our reputation is everything. And that is a core belief in our business, that we are honest and have a lot of integrity. Respect. Just remember, respect others, respect yourself. You might need to earn somebody's respect, and that's okay. You just show them that you're able. But it's big, and you need to treat people fairly and with respect, just as much as you would want to receive it. Confidence. Always be willing to take a chance and go into the uncomfortable situation maybe sometimes. Know that you are good at what you do and you have your abilities and believe in yourself. And confidence will allow you to take risks in certain situations that may be new to you, like giving a speech in a management lecture series. You know, these things, you know, it takes some confidence. And you know, you don't know that it's going to be great, and you don't know that everybody's going to take away your thoughts and be like, oh, that was very insightful and very worthwhile. But you do it anyway. Confident that you have something good to say, somebody will take something away from it. But you know, if I didn't have confidence, I would never have the opportunity either. Optimism, not naivete. Realism, yes, but optimism. Choose to have a good day. Choose your situations may be chosen for you, the circumstances may be chosen for you, but choose to deal with them in a positive way. Look forward and look at the bright side of things. And I think it will really make a difference in the type of person that you are and how people relate to you. There are people, if you look around and you know that the people, you can probably name them of who is a glass half empty kind of person. But people also know that your glass is half full kind of person. And I think that they'll be more apt to come and ask for your support, ask for your advice or whatever, because you have that optimism. And it's certainly a more enjoyable way to deal with things. Adaptability, don't fear change. It's a good thing. Even if you don't know and you're a little nervous and you don't know what the outcome is, it's okay. Just be willing to make the change. Yeah. Trust yourself, trust the people that are around you, trust that you're making good decisions, and they are too. It's very, very important. And that moxie, we gotta love the moxie. Courage, determination, at the end of the day, that's what's gonna lead you a lot of the times. Dad calls it persistence, that is too. You know, I was sharing in my PSR class for a different reason, obviously it was a different lesson, but the message, you know, the Aesop's fable, the hare and the tortoise, and the hare challenges the tortoise to a race, and knowing full well that the tortoise is slower than heck and he's going to win. So they start the race, the turtle says, all right, let's do it. And the hare lays on its back and just taking a rest and knows that it's going to win. Well, in his relaxation and overconfidence, he lost the race. Yes, slow and steady wins the race, yes, all of that stuff, but to even go into the race, that turtle had some moxie. I mean, to go in knowing that you aren't guaranteed an outcome, a positive outcome, and to do it anyway, I think that that shows a lot in that little turtle. So that is what I have to offer you for my input in things that I feel are important in good leaders. I hope that as you journey on in your career path, your life path, that you take time to reflect upon those goals that you may have set up for yourself a long time ago, maybe in high school, maybe last year, maybe before you started college. You know, kind of take a moment to reflect on those things and figure out who it is that you are in your core and what you feel is important for a leader. So, thank you. You know, there's a company of one is not really going to be a very successful company. If you have a group of people that have been brought on board for the benefit of the company, and you still exist and work as though you are on your own, you're not going to be as effective. You're going to forget about things. You're going to, you know, not have the ability and the insight in the areas that your teammates bring with them. Does that make sense? You know, it is important to have a team. It is important to utilize your team. But it's, you know, I'm trying to, it's difficult to really put your finger on the most important part of teamwork, really. You know, I try and think of things that are challenging, business opportunities, robobots, teams, whatever. And it really couldn't exist without a team anyway. It's everything. So you need to relate to your teammates. You need to work together. They are equally counting on you. Keep that in mind. Not only are you counting on them, they're counting on you. So make sure that you are doing every bit of your part to be a valuable member of that team, and instead of just relaxing and letting somebody else do it for you. I think that's a huge thing. The difference, you know, having an industry that is largely male or has been for a long time, it's really an opportunity for young women. If you have the passion for engineering and science and math, you know, it might be a logical choice. There are many, many programs that are, you know, found at Case or Lakeland or wherever you may be. And I think all those engineering classes and manufacturing classes are a little bit more evenly spaced with men and women these days. We talked a little bit about during dinner, you know, being involved in women in manufacturing or, you know, this push. I really feel that it is important to encourage everyone to pursue careers in manufacturing as an option. There are a lot of manufacturers out here in Lake County, around Northeast Ohio. These companies often are large, you know, have multiple hundreds of employees, and they have people that are customer service. They have people that are accounting, and they're good places to seek employment, regardless of whether you're going to be a machinist or not. I don't see it necessarily, I guess, because of maybe it's a generational thing. You know, I don't necessarily see it as my challenge to break into the workforce as a woman. I do feel it's a challenge sometimes to have that work-family balance. I think that that's difficult sometimes, because to have a family and to have a successful career, I mean, those are two full-time jobs. And sometimes you run the risk of feeling like you're not good at either one of them. You know, you have a little bit of time here being a mom, you have a little bit of time being an employee or a leader or a manager or whatever, and you don't have the ability to focus 100% of your time on any one thing. So it's a challenge, but it's doable. I mean, if you want it and you set out your priorities, I mean, at the end of the day, my family is the most important. You know, that somebody, when they were giving a speech, and I wish I could remember who it was, with the Women's Leadership Initiative, she gave the example that it's like juggling balls. You know, you can, this one's up, this one's down, whatever, it's a rotation. But your family, that ball is glass. You know, the other things might be able to bounce back if you drop it, but the family part, that could break. So it's kind of, I think of that when I try and prioritize. I mean, you can, at the end of the day, my most important prized possession is my family, whether it's my children, my husband, my parents, my brother, my whatever. I think it's more the work-life balance that I think is a challenge for most women these days, more so than a gender exclusion in a particular industry. And I think when we were at Case, just happened to be taking a tour, and they have an engineering program. They were commenting that there are a lot more women in engineering now. So I think it's a good thing. I think that we'll see it leveling out. A lot of it, you know, comes from that personality, that formation of your personality when you were younger, and the influence of family and economy and issues that are affecting you then, or your parents then, or however. So, you know, they have a different, not a different set of values necessarily, but a different way of doing things based on their experience. And it doesn't mean that there is no value of a certain style of leadership or a certain way of doing things, you know, that are very systematic or, you know, less, how do you want to say it, less doing things on a whim or having the courage to take a big step. You know, I think that maybe that's more, younger people are more inclined to do that kind of thing versus a systematic approach. And I don't know if it's just the opportunities that we've been given, the kinds of things that interest us as children, how our parents are, if they're more confident. You know, I think that there definitely is a difference. And the most successful leader or manager or whatever has to identify what those differences are, even just based person to person. Man to woman, generational differences. See what the difference is, kind of identify it, and figure out a way to work with it. You know, you don't want to just sit there and butt heads, and because your styles are different. You want to be able to maybe take what you feel, and if you know that this person is very black and white and very systematic, you know, you can present yourself, your ideas, same ideas, in a different way that appeals to their method of dealing with things or their way of doing things. So, it's not, you know, your way versus their way. It's just a matter of trying to get yourself understood by presenting yourself in such a way that'll be acceptable and accepted by the person, no matter what the difference is. We stopped using a lot of paper. Dad's a note guy, I think, with the introduction of the email, you know, kind of helped him with that one. It's, we're certainly not one of those the industries that you'll see the lead building and, you know, a green roof and all of that kind of stuff being at the forefront. That's not to say that we don't deal with those issues, the recycling of scrap and things like that, recycling cardboard and, you know, doing things that help the environment, that help, you know, that are sustainable. You know, we do it where we can. It's not always practical, but we are, I mean, we're not at the forefront. I hate to admit that, but, you know, it's something that I think everybody is working towards more so. And it's being more, it's certainly more reachable. You know, there's recycling people that pick up bottles and papers and all those things now. So I think it's just going to become more and more part of culture, every culture. All right, I think that's it. Thank you, I appreciate your time. Good luck to you.